Puppy gets a master. By Amarra Skye. Jamie didn't know he could be someone's puppy until he met Malcolm, the billionaire owner of the Phoenix, the hottest kink club in Colorado. Will Jamie accept his deepest desires as he falls for a man who makes good puppies sound like the hottest thing in the world? Malcolm, CEO of Crash, a tech company, as well as one of the hot doms of Denver's most exclusive kink clubs, hasn't had a sub to call his own in years. He's immediately attracted to the eager-to-please, sexy new bartender. Jamie. New to town and searching for the best-paying job, Jamie finds himself working at a kink club that would scandalize his small-town parents. Despite his reluctance, the first time Malcolm says good boy, a whole new world opens to him. Find out not only how Malcolm overcomes his fear of being used, but how Jamie gives into his newfound desires and finds the love and protection only a master can provide. Here at Audiobook Listens, you can feel good about listening to our books. Unlike other channels, we pay the authors. We are pirating these books. The authors who are part of our channel chose to share these books on YouTube, so it's free to you. The authors get paid from the ad revenue, so listen as much as you would like. If you would like to listen to without ads, you can buy a copy of the audiobook from the link in the description. Chapter 1. Jamie. I've been working at the Phoenix, the hottest BDSM club in Denver, for 2 weeks, but the manager hasn't let me do anything but bar back. Growing up bartending at the little dive bar my dad owned means I'm a decent bartender. Sure, fruity drinks weren't really what most people asked me to make back home, but enough people asked for them over the years that making them isn't too hard. It wasn't like my life was easy. But dad kicking me out for being gay wasn't in my life plan. Sure, I was over 18 so I could get an actual job and not have to turn tricks or try to survive with some part-time after-school bullshit, but the past 4 months have been the worst of my life. Dad kicked me out with like $50 to my name and no one to help me in Ouray, Colorado or anywhere else. It took me a while to find a place in Denver, but as of 2 weeks ago I am no longer living in my car and I found a decent job. The place is only an Airbnb, but at least I can keep warm and dry and have access to a shower every day. No matter how much of a fuck up Dad was, I've always paid the light bill and water bill so Dad and I could at least always shower and be warm. No matter how many times I told my new manager I'd been running my family's bar since I was 12, he wouldn't believe me. But since some waitress no-call no-showed, tonight's my chance to shine. The club's been a whole other world for me, and while I would have done just about anything for what they're paying me, I like this place. Sure, I've seen things I'd never even seen in porn, and it freaked me out a bit. To be honest, I kind of like what I've seen. Even the whips and pain didn't scare me as much as I thought they would. When Frank the manager told me about the club, I thought it would be awful. I thought I was going to hate it here, but I didn't. Sure, hearing people crying while you were walking around in a bar was shocking, but I wasn't as turned off as I wanted to be by the things I was seeing. I have to admit, there are scenes, that's what Frank called them, that I really enjoy watching. I don't think I've spent this much time fighting a boner since I was 15. One thing that captured my attention most were people with masks that make them look like a puppy, complete with tails and things that went over their hands to make them look like paws. And while I'd seen puppy porn online and quickly passed it by, this excited me. The outfits didn't do it for me or even the walking on leashes, although I want to walk on a leash. What really appealed was that the handler always made sure the pup was okay. The handlers would check on their pup's knees and hands. They would make sure no one bumped into them, hurt or disrespected them. I enjoyed seeing them dressed up as puppies, kittens, ponies, and I thought I might enjoy some of that. What I wanted was to be treated the way they treated the pets after the scenes. The handlers held, petted, and told their puppies how good they were and how proud their master was. In my entire life, as a straight-A student who took part in many clubs and played on sports teams, I could never make my dad proud no matter what I did. Hell, I think my dad knew he would have lost the bar years ago if not for me, and yet he still never expressed his pride in me. I don't know why watching random people get told they were good made me so jealous, but I wanted what they had, and I knew almost from the first day that I would do whatever it took to get that for myself. On my first night bartending at the Phoenix, one of the owners came in to check out the club. He was tall and well-muscled. He's the type of guy who could throw you over his shoulder or fuck you up against the wall. I'm not a little guy, and there's something about a man who is strong enough to manhandle me, I can't get enough of it. Frank told me one of the owners would be in tonight, but he hadn't told me the guy would hold court in the VIP section. The VIP section is a little platform in the front corner where people can view the entire club. It seems ostentatious if I'm honest. I mean a raised platform with black leather couches and partial walls so whoever is up there can see out, but you can't tell what they're doing behind the walls. The handsome dark-haired owner could get his cock sucked, and you really couldn't tell unless you went up to the platform with them. His hair is long enough you can run your fingers through if you can catch him before he puts a gallon of gel in it. Everyone needs hair product, but this guy makes sure no strand is out of place. It's hot, but he's the type of man who looks amazing when he's making his way out in the world. I imagine he's completely different when he's soft and sleepy. After seeing him, it's hard not to envision running my fingers through his hair after he fucks me senseless. Steel, our family's bar, is small, so growing up I never dealt with people like this man. Uray is a tourist town, though, so there's always someone around who wants to make sure you know you're poor white trash. The rich guys are the king of their own little mind, so this is nothing new to me, but still, dealing with the owner is not how I want to spend my night. Malcolm. Everyone in town knows me. I'm a local boy made good. My dad was a senator when I was growing up, and now to be one of the richest men in the country means I get more than my share of attention. And here in the club I own with my business partners, there's no one in the room who doesn't know I'm Malcolm White, one of the richest and most eligible bachelors in Denver, and a dom who almost every sub wants to be with. When I opened the Phoenix, the kink club my friends and I own, I wanted it to be a place where all of us from Crash, the tech company we own, could have a good time in the lifestyle. A place we can control in every way. 10 years later, everyone knows the top management of Crash is kinky to some extent, but when we bought the failing bar, we were trying to hide who we were, and owning the kink club we played it seemed like the best option to protect ourselves from getting outed. Thinking about how I've been alone for over 10 years just makes me depressed. I could walk up to any sub or switch in the room and have them for a night or more if I want, but they want the CEO of Crash or an owner of the Phoenix, they don't want me. They only want what I offer. I want a sub to collar and call my own, I want a partner to come home to, who will sit at my feet while we watch a game in my home theater. Sure, being rich has its perks, but going on amazing trips alone isn't what I want anymore. I have everything anyone could want except for someone to share my life with. I don't want someone who does things they don't want to do to please me, at least not all the time. I want someone who thrives as a sub, not someone who tolerates it. I gave up on vanilla dating in college, and people whose kinks don't line up with mine are always a disappointment, it just frustrates me. As hands-off at the club as I try to be, I always know who's new to the club, whether it's an employee or member. Normally when Frank hires someone, they're at least a member of the club. For someone to be new to the club and new to the scene is a rarity at the Phoenix. If Frank hired someone who didn't know about the lifestyle, we could end up with an employee who freaks on the first day and splits halfway through the night. Frank must have been desperate to hire someone like this kid to work here, but since Charlie no-showed for at least the third time, maybe Frank is right to hire someone who not only knows how to bartend but is also desperate for money. The new boy is behind the bar already, and he looks 18 at most. The kid is blonde and not a bottle blonde. I don't really have a type other than real. I like guys with tans, but not a perfect tan you get from a tanning bed. I want to see lines from where you go running or hiking. I like someone whose body tells a story and not the story of I spend all my free time working to look perfect. Even with women, I don't want fake tits. I want you to be real, even if that means you have small tits. The boy has a great body, but it's the body of someone who works for a living, not the perfect muscle of someone who spends 5 hours a day in the gym. He's beautiful, but he moves with ease and grace for a kid who doesn't look old enough to get into the club. He moves with the sure, steady movements of someone who can do his job on autopilot. It's rare to see someone even 25 who can move around in a new bar like he owns the place without looking like a stuck-up dick. The boy doesn't look like a dick at all. He's all contradictions, young but sure enough of his job to be steady. In control, but not cocky. The boy is such an interesting addition to the club. Watching him, I realize I want the boy in my bed. It's poor form to fuck an employee, it's how you get sued. But for this boy, I might have to make an exception. With Crash being a kink-owned company with several gay, bi and pan owners, we have more than our share of lifestyle employees who've worked for us over the years. Legal had to draw up a form for us to use so we don't get sued. I mean, I'm one of the richest men in America, so getting sued is possible with anything, but at least I can have the pup sign it if I fuck him. What am I thinking? I don't even know if he's interested. At the Phoenix, we pay better than other clubs in town, even the vanilla clubs don't come close, so it's no wonder a kid his age would put up with a lot to earn what we pay the help. Most patrons tip well, so a bartender can easily make a few hundred a night, even a slow night. The Phoenix is an expensive membership, and the door fee isn't cheap either. We keep it expensive to keep people from being too keen to sell us out to the paparazzi. If you can afford $2,000 a year for the membership and $20 to $50 a night for the door fee, you aren't likely to sell us out to the press. Now everyone at Crash is open about their sexual habits, but before we came out, having a club that catered to the rich was how we kept ourselves safe. I worried when the local tabloid came to me with a story about my sex life, but I talked to Crash's PR team. After a lot of discussion, we all came out as kinky and queer so we could steer the narrative. It caused a major drop in stock prices, but it rebounded quickly. It was a terrifying month, but I wouldn't change it for the world. Now I'm an out and proud kinky bisexual who doesn't have to live in fear of being caught with my metaphorical pants down. I get to be honest, and that's changed my life as well as the lives of the rest of the team. I normally don't pull this kind of shit at the club, but I'm going to ask for this boy to be my server tonight and to hell with the consequences. What I really want is to order him onto his knees, but since I value consent, I will settle for ordering him to get me drinks and be at my beck and call. Hey Frank, I'm going to need a private server tonight. Shit Mal, is everyone coming in? I didn't plan for that tonight, and Charlie no-showed. No, it's just me, but I'm in the mood for private attention. God, I'm a fucker. Hell, Frank was trying to ask me not to pull this shit with him tonight, and I just won't let it go. I am going to hell. Well, who am I kidding? I was going to hell long before this beautiful boy crossed my path. Although I let the managers make the hiring and firing decisions at the Phoenix, I'm very hands-on at Crash. I know all 300 of our employees by name and what they're most excited about. I work hard to be an owner who knows his employees, we all do. You can keep your employees 10 times longer if you just show them you care once in a while. Who do you have in mind? Frank asks, the frustration obvious in his voice. The new bartender. Frank knew who I wanted. The man had run the club for years and he could pick what would draw my eye. Hell, if a new member joined and Frank thought we would fit, he would give me a heads up. But with this new employee, I can tell he's not happy I'm pulling this shit. On his first trip to the VIP room with drinks, someone bumped into Jamie, and he righted himself like a cat. It was one of the most graceful things I've ever seen. Wow, what a graceful puppy you are. The comment is out before I notice I'm speaking, but the boy seems to glow with the simple compliment. I've been an out and proud bi man since my late teens. I knew the kid was gay. What shocks me is the way he seems to glow under my praise. Even the puppies and littles I play with now and then aren't so thrilled by a simple good boy. It's been years since I've had a play partner so excited by praise. The sub generally has to be emotionally invested in you to be so touched by a comment like that. But this boy, he just glows at a statement most wouldn't notice. I haven't seen a sub so easy to put down into sub space in years. I've sent the puppy running for drinks and snacks a dozen times. By the time the bar is getting slow, I'm buying drinks for people I don't even like just to have an excuse to send the boy running. No matter how many stupid trips I send him on, the boy only needs a good boy or a hand through his hair to make him smile and make his handsome face all bashful. I know it isn't uncommon for people to see the pay rate and be willing to give a kink club a try, and no matter how nervous it makes them to be around all the play, but this boy seems to enjoy at least the quasi-play I'm giving him. I hope he's not just a great actor, because this boy has already burrowed under my skin. Being the owner of the club, I can take some liberties without being a creep, although it's a delicate line. The pup seems pleased with the attention and affection I've been giving him. I can't help myself, the boy is just too much fun to play with. What's your name, puppy?
Jamie, sir.
God, that sir, it practically killed me to hear the way it just slid out of his mouth. I want him on his knees. The way he says it makes me want to promise him anything just to have him be mine for a little while. The things I would do to have this boy. I've heard enough sirs in my life to tell the difference between genuine and bullshit. This pup is one of those rare people who gives the honorific out of sheer knee-jerk reaction to a strong dominant. It thrills me like no sir has in years. Having owned a club like this for over a decade, I've heard sir a lot. Rarely is it from someone who isn't either angling for something from me or just doing what I expect. The sir makes me want to do such dirty things to the boy, but since the pet is working and I don't want to be sued, I'll settle for calling him puppy and telling him how well he's doing. Chapter 2. Jamie. The only reason I went to work at the Phoenix was because of the money. I'm gay and have seen some kink in porn, it isn't my thing. But the money is too good to pass up, so I'm willing to try it out and see if I can handle the club. It doesn't require me to do anything sexual or even get naked. The outfit was revealing, but I still have clothes on, and the customers aren't allowed to touch without my consent. So far, it's been okay. The first couple of nights were slow. The first night was TNG, someone said it stood for the next generation, it wasn't bad since everyone was young, 18 to 35. The people treated me very well, the tips weren't as good as other nights, but I didn't feel too uncomfortable and I still made like 20 times more than I would have made at Steel. After the first night, I got more used to the things going on around me. Tonight is the first time I met any of the owners. According to Frank, there are like 10 owners of the club, but Malcolm, the guy here tonight, is the most hands-on of the owners. I can tell Frank doesn't want to send me away to Malcolm, but Frank doesn't seem like he thinks I won't be safe. It's that long-suffering look of someone who knows the owner is being a dick and yet they have no control over it, so they will deal. Frank seems far more pissed that he's going to be behind the bar than that I'm having to run errands for the owner. So far no one has really interacted outside of drink orders and scheduling a private room, but the owner is different. Every time I go to his table, Malcolm tells me I'm good and comes up with some reason to touch me. So far, all the touches have been non-sexual. I mean, who am I going to tell if I don't want him to touch me? But if I'm being honest, I don't mind the way Malcolm treats me. If Frank told me this would happen, I'm not sure I would have been okay with it, but somehow Malcolm makes me feel safe and even excited with the way he praises and touches me. To say that my folks were hard is an understatement. My mother divorced my father and moved when I was 6. By the time I was 10, she didn't speak to me anymore, and by the time my dad kicked me out, I didn't even have a working number or address for her. And dear old dad is an alcoholic. He owns a bar and was always drunk by mid-afternoon. When I got home from school in high school, he was smashed, but he was a 2 fingers of bourbon in my coffee guy when I was 4 or 5. Why my mother left me with him, God only knows. Well, I mean, she split and never talked to me again, so I guess she never cared. Still, she had to know he was a drunk when she left me in his care. Working for my dad was how I learned to tend bar. Someone had to make drinks and take care of customers when dad was shit-faced. By the time dad kicked me out, I was doing the ordering and making sure all the bills got paid. All dad did was sign the checks and have the legal paperwork in his name. It's sad to think dad will lose the bar within a year without me there to run it for him, but what can I do? Neither one of my parents ever praised me for anything. I was more likely to get called names or slapped than told I was good or worthy. Maybe that's why it's so comforting when Malcolm tells me I'm good. Last call comes over the loudspeaker in the front room and the lights flash in the back. I know the front will clear up quickly,
but over the past couple of weeks I learned the back takes a while for people to wrap up their evening and be ready to go. I'm swinging by Malcolm's table to make sure he's okay when he pats the seat next to him. There's something about the way his brows furrowed that makes me want to run, but a larger part of me wants to sit down and let the older man call me a good boy just one more time. "Did you need something, sir?" I ask, embarrassed by how young my voice sounds when I speak to this handsome dark-haired man. "Yes, puppy. I want to know what you think of my club. Sit down and tell me." He pats the seat again. I want to sit. Somehow following directions is compulsive. I feel like this beautiful man must be obeyed for some unknown reason. God knows I've fooled around with men before. Locals from Uray, my age and older, as well as a few tourists. But I've never had a man compel me to do whatever they ask the way it is with Malcolm. It's sexual, but there's also a safety in the way I feel when I obey him. Somehow, I know all I have to do is follow Malcolm's orders and I'll be safe. I'll be his good boy. I want to be his good boy. Chapter 3. Malcolm. I watch and can't help but smile at the puppy. The kid has no poker face. Every thought the boy has rolls across his face. The blonde enjoys being told what to do, but when I call him puppy or say he's my good boy, he practically glows. Owning a club like the Phoenix, I've had no shortage of play partners or one-time play. But it's been more than a decade since I met anyone I wanted to play with long-term. When I collared my ex, we had both been in the lifestyle for a while. I thought our friendship and romantic interests were enough to make up for the less than an ideal mesh of our lifestyle needs, but he was not a lifestyle sub. Quickly, my ex didn't want to sub, at least outside of a specific scene. He was a bedroom sub and a switch if he'd been honest. It wasn't 6 months into him wearing my collar he started wanting to bring people home so we could play together. I love to play with multiple people at once, and maybe if we found a boy to collar as a sub for both of us it would have worked longer, but my ex was jealous of people who were more than just a casual play partner, and topping someone for a night isn't what I need. I'm a lifestyle dom and I want a 24/7 dynamic. I don't know if I want a slave, but I don't want a bedroom partner. The way this boy looks at me and the way he glows with pride at my praise, I know he longs for true domination even if he doesn't have the vocabulary to express those needs yet. I must be careful to let him figure out what he needs and wants, not just tell him. You can tell a seasoned sub a lot of things, but life changers like, "Hey, I think you're a submissive who would enjoy giving up all control to me and being my boy full time," isn't something you can come out and tell someone. You can hint, cajole, lead, praise, poke, and prod, but they normally need their own aha moment. I know if I'm not careful, I'll push this puppy into something he doesn't want. He's far too eager to please. He'll say yes to things just so I'll be proud of him and then regret it later on. I'm going to have to go slow. I hate going slow. I'm far too used to the play partners I have now who know the lifestyle and what they want and what their limits are. The last thing I want to do is push the pup away by telling him what he wants. "Sit," I say, putting a little more command in my voice to stop the puppy from overthinking things. So much for not pushing the puppy too hard. "Tell me what you think of the club." "Well, it's overwhelming, to be honest." "You're always to be honest with me. I have enough people in my life telling me what I want to hear. What's overwhelming?" I have to suppress a grin when the puppy blushes from his cheeks to his nipples. "Oh, this boy will be fun to play with. Well, I guess I kinda like some things I've seen here. I'm watching this girl get led around on a leash. I kinda liked it." "Well, if I'm being honest, I more than kinda liked it." "What else did you like?" I want to know what the boy thought of the pain play going on in the back room, but don't want to scare the pup. There was a woman in a blue leather corset, and her, I don't know the term for it, maybe pet. Well, she was hand-feeding her pet while the pet sat on a big cushion. The pet just looked so well taken care of and happy. I never knew things like that were something I could want, but the pet looked so safe and content. I guess I just wanted that for myself. I have to stop myself from smiling as I watch this boy talk about being a puppy. "Was there anything else you liked?" The pup is getting more confident, but he looks like he might bolt if I push too hard or force him to look at what he wants in a way that scares him. I saw a man all tied up in ropes and suspended from the ceiling, and it was super cool. The ropes were so pretty, and it looked so exciting to be hanging up there for the entire room to see. Wow, this boy really would be a blast to play with. Shibari isn't my thing, but it seems like the pup is more into the room watching him than being all tied up. I have the toy bag and skills to get noticed in a club like mine. Fire is never my go-to for play. I enjoy it, but it doesn't do it for me, but when you roast marshmallows on your sub, the room takes notice. I can come up with plenty of ideas to get the puppy noticed if that is his kink. What about Kiara? Did you see her setting her little pet on fire? I saw a woman burning things all over a man. It was cool looking, but I don't want to get hurt, at least not damaged. That is her pet, and they go by they/them pronouns. I wanted to ask if the boy saw anything he would like to try, but the simple correction had the puppy looking crestfallen and pulling back into himself. It was like night and day from the openness the blonde boy was showing moments ago. As many liberties as I took with the puppy earlier, soothing someone who wasn't mine to soothe was a step too far, at least before we negotiated. But the pup looks like he might shut down and never be this open again. I would do just about anything to keep the pup this open and talking. I'm sorry that came out a little harsh. I know they look very masculine, but they're neither male nor female, and so many people can't bother to learn their pronouns or care to use them. I care deeply for Kiara and her pet. Basil lived with me for a while, and I still feel very protective of them. They never belonged to me, but they wore my collar of protection for 3 years, and I take that kind of thing seriously. Jamie looks more confident than a moment ago, but still not as open as he was before the correction. I'm so happy he understood I wasn't mad at him. I was trying to protect Basil. Is there anything you want to try for yourself? I know I shouldn't be so forward. God knows if I were a decent man, I would offer to find him a good safe top to play with, but with how submissive the pup is, I know I need to be the one to show the lifestyle to this boy. I don't mind offering a collar of protection to people who I'm friends with. There are very few doms in town or even the state who would go against me enough to get me to ban them. I'm on the board for half a dozen kink events nationwide, and our software division at Crash came up with a software system to help clubs know if there was a predator in their community. Watchdog has been out for about a year, and almost every club in the country is using it to keep track of consent violations, so you can't start going to another club after you've been accused of a consent violation in a club. I could set the boy up with many safe tops and let him try things out, and for most noobs I worked with in the past, that's exactly what I did. Not him, though. This boy is under my skin after a few minutes of conversation. Hell, Basil lived with me for almost 3 years and I loved and adored them, but I never wanted to keep them forever. I think I would like to try being hand-fed and walked on a leash, and maybe the rope thing? I can't keep the smile off my lips at the way the pup sounds so hopeful and nervous as he poses what he wants as a question to me. Most people assume doms/doms are cold and never laugh or giggle in a scene, but I'm quick to smile. I think a smile or giggle when you're about to do something terrible is even more terrifying. I will hurt you, and worse, I'll do it with a smile and a giggle. Do you have an interest in being my puppy? I do my best to keep my voice from betraying how much I want to play with this young man. Jamie. I've watched my share of porn. As a kid, Dad didn't know enough or care enough to put parental filters on my computer. I stumbled upon kink in various forms over the years, and while some of it was interesting, none of it really did it for me. Hell, I've seen guys on leashes and wearing pup hoods before. What surprised me about the club and talking to Malcolm were the things I'd seen in porn and never been the slightest bit interested in. Suddenly I couldn't wait to try. No matter what was going on, almost everyone bottoming, was the term others used to describe it, looked so relaxed and like they were safe and cared for. I hadn't had a happy childhood, and while my father hit me, it wasn't like Dad beat me, but Dad was never shy about telling me what a disappointment I was and how much he didn't want me. I was the brat Dad never wanted, and nothing more. I wasn't naive. I didn't think this man I just met loved me or would fix me, but maybe for a little while I could luxuriate in the care and praise. I saw others getting in the club. It's clear Malcolm enjoys praising me. Every time he said I was good, Malcolm seemed to light up a bit too. I can't remember the last time anyone told me I did a good job. I think I would like to try something. I would enjoy being a puppy, but I have never really thought about it before, so I don't know how it will be when I do it, but I want to try. I felt more certain about what I wanted as I told Malcolm. Very well, puppy. I am going to let you get back to work, and when it's time for you to leave, you come find me. Chapter 4. Malcolm. As much as I want to drag the puppy to the back and play with him right this minute, I know I need to be careful with this one. It's clear the pup has done nothing kinky. By what the pup was saying, I don't think he's even watched kinky porn before, let alone thought about doing something like this. I should give him a nice sampling and let him figure out what he likes. The problem, in my experience, subs sample with many people and then found the right dom for them. I don't mind sharing to an extent, but with this puppy, I don't want a short-term partner. It's taken me far too long to be interested in someone the way I am with this puppy. I already know I can't let him go after a single session. Normally when I play it's at the club, what is the point of owning the place if I can't take advantage of using it when it's closed? But for this pup's first time, I want to take the boy home and give him a good time. It's baffling how I was so enamored after spending less than an hour interacting with him. I've never been one to fall easily, so being so lost on this boy is a new world. I know who and what I am. I'm good-looking, rich, and a skilled DOM fuck. I own the club. Lots of people want to play with me for any or all those reasons. Sadly, none of those things are who I am as a person. The pup doesn't seem starstruck or even lustful in a way that means he only wants a pretty face. Since this puppy hasn't set off my radar for only being interested in what I can offer or who I am, I can break my own rules and take the puppy home for his first scene. Jamie. It seemed like Frank was trying to make everything take as long as possible to get things wrapped up. It pleased me I couldn't just leave with Malcolm because it gave me time to think if this was what I wanted. Part of me hates that I can't just leave because it gives me too much time to think. In the hour it took to get my side work done, I must have flip-flopped 100 times. Luckily or not, depending on how things go tonight, I am ready to leave. I don't know what the protocol is for approaching someone to play with in this context, so I go for how I would act with anyone else I was trying to pick up in a bar. Sure, over my days at the club I've seen people crawl to a dom or walk up and kneel in front of them, but none of those options felt right, so I go with what I know. I walk up with as much confidence as I can muster and sit on the couch close enough that Malcolm can touch me, but far enough the older man will have to reach if he wants to pet me. Maybe I was wrong and you're a kitten and not a puppy? Malcolm asks, smiling at me. What? I can hear the way my voice sounds when I say what, but I can't stop the shock in my voice. I'm trying so hard to do the right thing with this beautiful man, and it seems like everything I do is wrong. I want to crawl away and hide under his powerful gaze. You must have never owned a cat growing up. They love to sit either on your face, book, or laptop, so they must be paid attention to, or they sit just far enough away you can only pet them if you reach, Malcolm explains, a fond smile on his face as he speaks. The gentle smile helps put me at ease, but I still want to hide from his knowing gaze. Sorry, I say, trying not to sound chastised. But no matter how much rejection I experience in my life, the slightest comment from Malcolm feels more. I don't really know what it feels more of, but it feels more. Maybe it feels more important. The way disappointing your dad feels different than disappointing your teacher, no matter what you think of that teacher. I don't want to feel so deeply for a man I met tonight, but every praise, every rebuke seems to matter so much more than a simple comment from a bar patron should matter. Why can't I make sense of the way I feel about him? I can't seem to relax around him unless he's actively praising me. I feel like I should guard my emotions from the dark-haired stranger, but some part of me, deep inside, knows I would get nothing out of my interaction with Malcolm if I don't lean into these feelings of vulnerability. I mean, wasn't the vulnerability offered by the sub and the care and affection shown by the dom the very thing that excited me in the scenes I watched? The point of playing with this man is to get all those warm fuzzy feelings I see other people having, and if I don't open myself to the risk, how will I get the reward? I don't want to get hurt, and if I let myself be vulnerable with this man, he'll be able to hurt me so much more when he rejects me. Malcolm. I see the pup's face fall at my comment, and it shocks me. Sure, there's a certain amount of vulnerability in any kind of play, but this boy wears his heart on his sleeve. I've seen doms take a sub down and then tear them apart and put them back together better than they were before. Hell, I've even done it a few times with long-standing play partners. It just isn't the way I like to start a relationship with someone new. Deep emotional scenes are something I plan and take my time with, but as I watch the boy get so distraught by my cat comment, I realize any kind of play would be emotional for him. He's starved for praise and touch. It's obvious he needs both so badly. I don't want to assume anything about the boy, but I'm not thinking he had a happy childhood. Fuck me, he is still a kid at 18, we all were, but there's something in his eyes that speaks of growing up far too soon. It's in his every move. He's both far older than 18 and far younger. I've played with enough people to know any scene will be emotional for him. I hope playing with him doesn't leave him more broken than he is now. I like to use the Colorado motto when I play with my partners. Take only memories, leave only footprints. I could see how this pup would thrive under the right dom, and I only hope he lets me be the dom he'll give his submission to, because whoever he gives that gift to will be a very lucky man. Puppy, I wasn't chastising you. I was trying to be funny. I could see the words weren't really hitting home with the puppy. He looked like I kicked him. I don't know what to do to make him see I was only playing. Oh, Jamie says, looking like he's still expecting me to chastise him further. Do you want to come to my house to play? I ask, hoping it will take that sad, broken look off my puppy's face. I wondered if I should pull him into my lap as I spoke to him. Yes. The way the puppy said yes was like sunshine after a rainstorm. Everything about the boy lit up, and the way he smiles, both sheepish and vulnerable, it's all I can do not to lift him up and kiss him. Chapter 5. Jamie. I grew up in a tourist town. I can tell by the clothes Malcolm wears that he's rich. And that was before we got into the Bentley SUV. I didn't know Bentley made an SUV, but driving up to the house, I was adding a few extra zeros to what I imagine is in his bank account. The house is in Cherry Creek and takes up almost an entire block. I never paid much attention to housing costs, but there's no way this place isn't $10 million or more. Here I am pretty much a homeless kid, in thrift store jeans and a band shirt with a hoodie I never gave back to a high school hookup. What the fuck is this guy doing with me? Hopefully not chopping me up or locking me in a cage to keep as a slave. Well, maybe the cage, but only if I can leave when I want to. Maybe being this guy's slave wouldn't be too bad. I mean, I bet the cat gets top-end bougie cat food. I live on dollar menu food and whatever I can take from work. I about shit myself when we pull into the garage. Oh my fucking god, the Bentley was probably the least exciting car in the garage. I am not a car guy, I was too poor growing up to be into them, and even from a distance they weren't my thing. I love my 10-year-old Subaru Outback, but I don't love the car. I love that it's mine and can't be taken away from me. I love that it's good in the snow and it's practical. Cars like his you love because they're beautiful and go fast. As much as I want to go in the house and see what awaits me, I want to stand here and drool over the cars. Next time we go somewhere, I'll let you pick the car. How does that sound? I must look like I want to hump his cars because the look on his face is indulgent, like a parent buying something for a kid, not because the kid deserved it or as a gift, but because the thing would make their child happy. But what catches my attention isn't even the way he says it, though him indulging me makes me smile. What has me about melting into a puddle on the floor in the garage is the next time part. I know better than to catch feelings for a one-night stand, especially when you're about to fuck your boss, but I'm so lost for this man, and we haven't even made it to the house. That he might want me for more than tonight, thought makes me so giddy I suddenly understand those stupid girls who get their boyfriend of 3 weeks' name tattooed on their necks. I would absolutely never be that dumb, but for a moment I understand the feelings that led to those piss-poor choices. There's a huge part of me that wants to run away from this perfect man even more now that I can see how rich he is. I mean, he has to know I'm poor white trash, right? My mom ran off. Dad was a drunk who owned a bar in a mining town where the mine was all but dried up. We have tourists in the summer, but it's a dirty little town with nothing to offer. Sure, I'm pretty, but lots of people are pretty and it's not like I'm model pretty. I'll never be a model or a movie star, not that I want to, but still, I'm not any of those things. Malcolm is all those things and more, rich, successful, famous if you are into tech nerds. So why is he here with a piece of trash like me? I never felt more like a dog than I do now. Malcolm didn't talk much on the drive, and as we walk into the house, he seems to expect me to follow him like the puppy he claims I am. The whole thing is slightly disconcerting, and yet I don't think my cock has ever been harder. I think if he commanded me to come right this moment, I could with nothing more than his order. Malcolm. Sit. The words come out as more of a command than I'm aiming for, so I add a please, but it sounds like the afterthought it was. I must do better at not ordering the pup around, at least until we talk about consent. I'm a cruel bastard, but consent violations are a whole new level of shitty. I won't violate his consent, no matter how hard my cock is as I order the pup around. I can't tell by looking at the boy if he's freaking out or about to come in his pants. And as new as he is, I'm not sure he knows, either. I'm old enough and have been in the scene long enough to know not to pin your hopes and dreams on a partner you haven't played with yet, but I was having a hard time not doing exactly that. Hell, who was I kidding? I was already scheming how to keep this boy forever. The pup has this quality that makes me want to hug him and kiss him and call him mine forever. What the fuck is wrong with me? If I was a good man, I'd send the pup home on principle, just to make sure I wasn't projecting my wants and needs on him. Play could wait a night to let cooler heads prevail. But I am, as Shepherd Book and Firefly would say, going to the special hell. So, I don't call him an Uber or take him home, I walk to the couch and sit. Taking a deep breath, I do my best to push my hopes back to a manageable level so I can look at this puppy for who he is and not who I want him to be. Normally, I'm good at staying detached and being rational, but this boy makes my brain short circuit. I want to talk to you about what we're going to do tonight and see how you feel about it. Can you talk to me honestly for a few minutes? Yes, sir. For the rest of this conversation, you won't use any honorifics. We are talking as equals. I will not be mad at you for telling me things you want or don't want. No matter what happens tonight, I will do nothing to jeopardize your job at the Phoenix. Let me repeat, your job is not and will not be on the line. You have every right to say yes or no to anything. I don't know or I'm not sure is also a valid answer. Anything you say no to or I don't know about tonight will be off limits for this evening and we'll talk about it again after you've played a little more or even tomorrow when you are out of the scene. You are absolutely allowed to change your mind. I want to make that clear to you. With me or anyone else you ever play with. You can revoke consent at any time. You have that right. As much as I tried not to show how much I wanted to make this an ongoing thing, I knew I messed up and put future language in what I told the boy. Jamie nods and looks down at his hands as if his cuticles need his urgent attention. I don't think I made anything sound like a rebuke, but he sure looks like I did. This wasn't the first or even the 101st kink negotiation I've had, but somehow this boy got me tongue-tied and acting like it was my first time. Why can't I manage my expectations with this boy? At the club we talked a little about the things you wanted to try, but since you're new, why don't I talk a little, and you can tell me what sounds fun? I'm going to tell you things I like and things I don't like, because I want you to decide based on what you want and not what you think I want. Okay? I can do that. Jamie nods, his hands still in his lap as he speaks. Good. The puppy was on the tip of my tongue, but I held back at the last minute, trying to keep our conversation from sliding back to the uneven power dynamic. I know if I get my way there will be plenty of time to tell him he's a good puppy. You said you wanted to walk on a leash and be hand-fed. Do you think you'd like wearing a pup hood while you do those things? I knew the pup saw hoods at the club, but I was doing my best to be fair to him and not expect him to know what I was talking about. So, I pull out my phone and show Jamie some hoods. The look on the pup's face is a pure delight as he looks at the hoods. I will take that as a clear interest, I say, doing my best not to sound too pleased at the way his eyes swept back and forth over the pictures on my phone. I know I'm failing, but he is far too cute, all excited and wiggling over the idea of a puppy hood. I know I'll be spoiling this pup rotten within a week if he keeps this up. Yes, I'd like that very much. I've never really thought of being a dog before, but I like the idea of walking on all fours and wearing a hood. Do I get a tail? God save me now, I think as I try and fail and hiding my pleased expression at the idea of him in a hood and tail all happy and wiggly for me to enjoy. I figured this was coming. I grab my phone and pull up a picture of show tails and tail butt plugs, so I can show the pup. Of course, you get a tail. I have several types of tails you can try before I get you your own tail. Jesus, what the hell is wrong with me? Why can't I talk to this pup for 2 minutes without setting future expectations? I will get you a tail that doesn't go inside as well as a tail plug. Most pups enjoy the internal stimulation when playing at home, but people are assholes and will pull your tail not knowing it's inside you and that can damage a pup. And I don't want you hurt. Inside? The question comes out as a squeak. The fear was clear in his voice as he spoke. I hope I didn't scare him, but based on his squeak, I think I might have. Yes, puppy. Lots of people enjoy a tail that's a butt plug. See? I ask, showing him the tail plug options on the website. Okay, Jamie says, his voice back to normal range and his hands no longer ringing at quite such a frantic pace. I think he even looks excited about the idea, but I might be wrong. How about sex? I ask. I normally would discuss hard limits and more in-depth questions about the scene, but he's so new I decide not to throw too much at him. I don't know why I now decide that I don't want to throw too much at him when I've been doing it all night, but I do. Go me. I mean, I thought sex was going to happen when I agreed to come here. The boy certainly sounds like sex wouldn't be a hard limit. Oh yes, puppy. I have a powerful desire to fuck you, but that isn't necessary for kink play, so I didn't want to assume you and I were going to have sex. Some people enjoy non-sexual play from time to time, and for some their play never becomes sexual. Well, I would like it to become sexual. As the boy spoke, his cheeks turned the brightest color pink. I couldn't help but imagine what the boy will look like when I embarrass him and he's naked. I bet I can get him to turn pink to his nipples. Very good. I'm HIV negative and on PrEP, but I use condoms with all of my non-collared partners, so we'll use condoms for the foreseeable future. I have a very simple sort of an introductory scene in mind for tonight. I think you'll like it. We can talk more about what you want to try as things proceed. Since you work in the club, you'll get to see a lot of types of play, and you can tell me what you want to try next time we play. As submissive as the boy is, he's not naive and doesn't seem like one to get run over by someone else's wants or needs. Do you have anything you know you don't want to try? I can tell you exactly what I have planned, but I don't have to if you don't want to have the scene spelled out for you. Some people like the element of surprise, some people don't. I'm not planning on doing anything painful with you tonight. And mostly just hanging out with my puppy and eating a late night snack. Then sex? Dear God, puppy, yes, then sex. You will spend the night here and hang out around the house tomorrow while I get some work done. You have never been in subspace before, and I don't want you to drop after we play. You don't have to sleep in the bed with me now or ever if you don't want to. I have a guest bedroom or a dog crate in my bedroom. We can play that by ear. But you will stay here tonight. Okay. Are you ready to go upstairs to the playroom? Yes. Okay, puppy, after this we are starting our scene and you will use sir when you address me. I expect you to go into what's called puppy space. I won't be surprised if you go nonverbal. You really can't do much that will get you in trouble tonight since you're new and we've never played before. Try to enjoy tonight. I'm going to use red, yellow, and green for your safe words. I know since you work at the club you've had training on how safe words work. I expect you to use them. If you can't speak and need a safe word, tap 3 times on anything including me and the scene will stop. You will never be in trouble for stopping a scene. You will be in trouble if you don't stop a scene and I find out afterwards you knew you needed things to stop and you didn't. Yes, sir. Chapter 6. Jamie. A huge part of me wants to ask for a ride home, but a bigger part of me wants to sink into what he called pup space and be taken care of and enjoy the comfort I saw others getting at the club. Sure, I might end up raped and killed or kept in some dark basement forever, but I don't think Malcolm would risk it. He gave me over an hour to tell someone where I was going. I mean, I didn't tell anyone where I was going because I don't have anyone to tell, but the beautiful man doesn't know that. Also, I don't think I've ever been more on board with a sexual partner than I am with Malcolm, and he talked so much about what I wanted, I didn't know I should ask those questions. I know he could be fake, but that seems like a lot of work to make me feel safe and then rape and kill me after he got me to his house. But what do I know? I could end up dead in an alley. You're thinking way too hard over there, Malcolm says, as we walk up the stairs. Sorry, sir, I say as I follow Malcolm into the playroom. The playroom turned out to not be a room at all. It must have started out as 4 rooms before he converted it, because it is huge. It is almost as big as the main play space in the club, and it has almost as much furniture as the club. The walls are covered in hanging toys, and the far corner is filled with a 4-poster bed with an elaborate system of what looked like ropes and restraint points. In the corner opposite the bed is a table built on top of what I can only guess is a human-sized dog cage with pillows and soft blankets covering the floor of the cage. I can't keep myself from walking past Malcolm and over to the cage, even dropping to my knees in front of the cage so I can look inside. Yesterday, if someone asked if I wanted to be locked in a cage, I would have said no, but kneeling here, it's all I can do not to climb inside and curl up and take a nap. I know if I go in the cage and ask her to close the door, I can leave my human problems behind. I can spend a day, hell even an hour, not worrying about rent and bills and if my father will be okay. Somehow, I just know I can leave my problems behind if I can let her take the stress for just a little while. If my dad taught me anything growing up, it was to take a rest where you can get it. Dad left me with far more stress than he should have, but when he was sober or even drunk but taking care of things, I learned to relax. You never know when you'll get your next chance to relax. I won't let Sir take my stress away. I'm like a little kid who is fighting sleep when they want to sleep, and God knows you want them to sleep but they just won't go to bed, and they keep getting more and more upset. The only thing is, I don't know how to take the next step. I'm sure if I go in the cage, sir, we'll move forward in some way, but I'm not sure that's the right direction for me. You look like you're thinking very hard over there. Does the puppy like the idea of the cage? You can climb inside and go to bed and relax, or you can come over to the closet and put on the hood and tail and I'll make you a snack and we can watch TV and see how you feel then? I can finally breathe again. I don't have to figure anything out, there are 2 options and if I'm honest, they are both good options. I don't think I will be getting fucked if I opt for the cage, so I stand and walk to what has to be the closet door. Malcolm. I've never seen such a new sub be so drawn to a cage before. I don't need the boy in a cage to do bad things to the boy, but the cage would make it way too easy for someone to take advantage of him. Before you play with someone in a cage that locks or a full body restraint, you need to know they aren't the type to hurt you, and the boy was clearly about to go in the cage. I don't know why I keep acting like I'm going to let this puppy play with anyone else if he'll have me. I can't even pretend I'm willing to let him go at this point. What am I going to do? I'd never been in this deep so fast before. I'm not sure. I think I want to try the cage, maybe, but not tonight. One day I want to spend a whole day being your good puppy locked up in my master's cage while I wait for him to come home and play with me. You're welcome to try it out now, puppy. I had something a little less drastic in mind for your first time, but you are more than welcome to see how you like the cage. I'll stay over here by the closet so you don't have to worry, I'll close the door. You can see how you like it, or I can help you into pup gear and we can go get that snack I was talking about. What is pup gear? Jamie asks, his hand stilling and focusing more intently on me now that he has something to focus on. I'll have to remember to keep him focused when he seems to be thinking too hard.
Well, we talked about the hood. I have one you can try out.
I have 8, but I think yes and no is about all the pup can handle right now. He seems to be floaty and out of it already.
I'll need to keep that in mind as well.
If you like the hood, we can get you one of your own.
I have knee pads to make sure you don't get hurt crawling around, and mitts for your hands so you can't use your fingers.
Most people find it relatively easy to get into their pet space if they're in gear, but don't worry if you have trouble the first few times or always. People are different and that's okay.
I'm sure he's halfway there already, but I want to prepare him so he doesn't panic if he has a hard time finding his rhythm.
I have several tails you can choose from if you want a tail to wag.
I want to try everything, Jamie says, his voice going a little dreamy as he speaks.
Good puppy, I'll help you get all ready to be my pretty puppy.
Dropping to his knees, Jamie follows me to the closet so I can get undressed.
Seeing the way the pup drops to his knees, I know I'm going to make choices for him tonight I would normally let him make for himself, but he's too pliant and probably too far in subspace for me to expect him to choose. I can hardly keep from rubbing my cock as he walks to the closet. My dutiful puppy being so perfect for me has me about coming like a teenager again.
What is it about this boy?
I grab a black leather collar that is soft but not what I'll get him if he agrees to wear my collar. I grab my blue and black neoprene hood and a set of matching mitts. They are what I'd put on a puppy of my own, but they're comfortable and simple and I want to get my boy geared up so I can get him doing other things. For this puppy, thinking is not good for his headspace.
I grab a set of knee pads I think will fit and set everything on the dressing table by the closet.
Oh my, this sweet boy would probably love to play service games with me.
I must teach him how to dress me.
I bet he would love getting me dressed.
I love service subs, but they require training if you want them to be useful.
For an occasional play partner, it's honestly more work than I want to put in for the reward. But with a sub I intend to keep, it will be worth the effort.
Shit, I should have asked the boy if he's a size queen before he got all floaty.
I do so love to use my biggest toys with my subs, but I'll restrain myself since I don't know his history.
I grab a smaller plug and a slightly bigger size in case he wants me to plug him up after I fuck him.
I'm never one to deny my partner a good plugging after I fuck them. For most of the people I play with, getting into their gear is part of what gets them into their pet space. But this pup is gone already. Hopefully, I can get him in the gear without having to bring him back.
I should bring him back at least a little because the pup isn't helping me put on his gear.
He's fighting me, but with his overthinking I'm not sure he'll be able to go down again if I bring him out right now.
So, I'm going to wrangle this pup.
Wish me luck, I think as I grab his paw and start pulling the mitts on.
The pup isn't super cooperative and finally I give up and slap the pup's ass.
Be still.
As soon as the words were out of my mouth, I can see the pup panic about being in trouble.
I'm sorry puppy, you aren't in trouble. You just need to be still so I can get you all ready to play.
Don't you want to play?
I can't believe how fast the pup settles. After the way he acted at the club, I thought he'd be harder to convince I'm not mad, but the pup surprises me again and freezes, holding his paw up and waiting calmly while I buckle them into place.
Chapter 7.
Jamie.
I feel like I'm high.
It's the strangest sensation. I can tell what Sir is saying if I pay attention, but I can relax and let the words become background noise with almost no effort.
I know Sir is talking, but it doesn't seem important to know what he's saying.
After he slapped my ass, I paid close attention. Now when he wants me to move, Sir pushes or pulls, and I move in whatever way he wants and then he pets my hair and tells me I'm good and I can float a little while longer.
Good boy, stay still, Sir says as he moves my head and slides a thing on my face.
I don't like it and I shake my head, the thing doesn't fall off, but he pets my back and I like that, so I freeze and stop moving.
Now that I'm still, I can feel him doing something on the back of my head.
I think it's a buckle since now it's tight against my face.
It doesn't hurt, so I go back to floating.
You're not helping. I can hear Sir say, but he doesn't sound mad. I think he's just talking to talk, so I go back to relaxing and not listening to him. If Sir wants me to do something, he'll let me know, and he said I won't be in trouble because I'm new, so I go back to letting him move me how he wants me and petting me. At some point Sir put knee pads on me, but I don't remember that, so I push it to the back of my mind and go back to letting him pet me. I like Sir petting me. Malcolm. After getting the gear on him, I take my time petting and stroking the pup's back and sides. The puppy pressed into every touch. I knew intellectually the pup was touch-starved, but seeing him so content and happy with simple strokes, I must have really underestimated how touch-starved the poor kid was. I know I'm going to have to pry into the boy's past, and I don't think I'm going to like what I'll hear. I resolve myself to help this cute puppy get what he needs out of tonight and hopefully many more nights, if that's what lets me keep my puppy. What an obedient puppy you are for me. I can't wait to see how well you behave for me tonight. I praise as I run my hands up and down the puppy. When the boy seems as blissed out as possible without falling over, I pull the pup's little black shorts down to get access to his tail hole. What an obedient puppy you are, Jamie. Does my pretty puppy want a tail he can wag for his master? Watching in awe as the puppy goes from blissed out to bounding around the room in excitement is probably the best thing I've experienced in years. Oh, I think my puppy wants a tail he can wag, I say, grabbing the pup's collar and stopping his wiggles with a firm tug. I don't want to damage the poor boy, but I need him to know he needs to stop moving. The pup did well with firm direction earlier and now is no different. The boy settles and waits for me to give him the next set of commands. I won't use the word calmly, but I will say he waits for me. I stuck the tail in my pocket earlier, so I'm ready to go. I show the boy the tail and honest to God he sniffs it. I don't want to know what it smells like, but he seems to want to know, so I let him. Jamie. Nothing ever felt as safe and right as being on all fours as this stranger rubs me and tells me I'm an obedient puppy. Sure, I thought I'd like being a pup and walking on a leash and even wearing the hood, but I never thought I'd feel so safe and carefree as I do now with this man petting and praising me for existing. I never want to leave this room or this moment. I know tomorrow I'll have to go back to being Jamie, but I can still push that thought to the back of my mind and enjoy Sir's hands on me, and that is what I am going to do. When Master reminds me of the tale, I don't know how to let him know what I want. The only thing I can think to do is bark, so I bark, and it sends a thrill up my spine. So I bark again, this time Master ruffles my ears, and I like the way I feel, so I bark again. Oh, I see you want a tail. Does my puppy want a tail that goes in his hole, or does my PU?
Arf!
I can't keep myself from barking at a tail in my hole. I know I'm being a bad puppy for interrupting, but I'm too excited to keep quiet. I try to apologize by petting my sir, but all I do is bump his hand, but he seems happy, so I focus on making him happy and keep trying to pet him back. I will take that as my puppy wanting the tail that goes in his hole.
Arf!
Okay, my sweet puppy, come with me and I'll put the tail in, then we can go eat something. I want my tail so badly, but I want snacks, and Sir said I'm getting both, so I'm going to do what Sir said. I walk to the bed, following like a good boy behind my Sir. I try to do the right thing and wait for my Sir to tell me what to do, but I'm not sure I'm being his good boy now. Sir isn't talking to me like before, and I made him wait for me. I'm trying to be an obedient puppy. I swear I am, but it doesn't seem to work, and I just want to make my Sir proud. When I get to Sir, he pushes me so I end up sprawled over the bed, and that isn't what good boys do. I am still trying to be good, but Sir seems frustrated and I need Sir to be happy with me, and everything is getting so much more complicated. It's hard to keep track of what's going on around me. It seems like I blink and Sir is in a new place and he isn't touching me. I try to pet him again, but I'm tied to the bed and I can't move to him. I don't like him being far away and not talking to me. I want my Sir to be proud of me and not frustrated, so I don't bark even though Sir seemed to like when I bark. But it all seems so difficult now. I will be a good boy and stay still and quiet like my dad always told me. I couldn't make my dad proud. Can I make Sir proud? I can feel myself panic because the part of my brain that let me relax and float was out of reach, and no matter what I do, I can't get back to that easy floaty feeling. But then my sir pets me again and talks to me, and the calm, happy part of my mind is so much closer than before. I still can't touch it, but I know I can get back to that place again. I don't feel like that place is gone forever. What a good pupper you are. Got a little worried when I went to grab the lube. I'm sorry, pup. I didn't mean to leave you alone. Next time I'll be more careful to keep in contact with you as I do things. That's my good pup. You're doing so well. Being so brave and sweet. I just know you are going to enjoy having a tail you can wag while we go see what we can find to eat. I know sir is still speaking, but I can touch that calm, happy place in my mind now, and I let what sir is saying slide just out of focus. I need not know what sir is saying because he's touching me again and he doesn't sound worried or mad. I should listen to what sir is saying, but I let myself drift back to that happy floaty play again. Somewhere on the edge of my awareness, I know something wet is being dripped onto my hole, but I'm safe and cared for, so I don't worry if it's the tail or master's cock. Instead of thinking about my master, I focus on what he's doing to my tail hole and how good it feels. I think he's using his fingers, but I could be wrong. Every so often, he rubs over that spot inside, and I think my eyes may roll back in my head a little. Sir is talking to me again, but I don't know what he says. I'm too busy trying not to come. Malcolm. I know better than to walk away from any sub without making sure they know what's about to happen. As a man who has sex with mostly men, how do you get everything but the lube? Better question, why isn't there lube by the bed in my playroom? That's it. Tomorrow, I'm ordering a case of it. By the time I get done, there will be lube everywhere. Jesus, what time is it? I think I'm getting punchy. This boy is too good for this world. When I talk, he settles back down. The more I babble about nonsense, his breathing evens out and his eyes no longer look terrified. I know better than to grab the lube so soon after I tied him up for the first time. Hell, even a seasoned pup can get panicky when you leave them restrained and unattended. I told the boy I was going to grab the lube, but he wasn't tracking well enough and I should have noticed. I was lucky to suit the pup back to his headspace at all, let alone so quickly. A new pup being so trusting with a new master is a rare treat and one I don't intend to waste. I think as I walk around the back of my puppy and run my fingers over his perfect ass. I can hardly wait to slide home in his tight bubble, but now isn't the time, but soon I'll know what that tightness feels like around my throbbing cock. I walk over and squirt some lube in my hand and down the crack of his ass and run my fingers over his hole. What a cute puppy. I can't wait to have my cock in this perfect ass. Just you wait, my sweet boy. You will get to enjoy my cock soon enough, I say, when I fuck the boy with two fingers, taking my time to work him open. I pulled my fingers out and lubed up the plug. Laughing at the whimper he made when his hole was empty. What a greedy little cock slut you are. You love to have your slutty little hole filled, huh? You want me to put this tail in you so you can be my little puppy, don't you? I slide the tail plug in and can't help but laugh at the way he fucks back on the plug when I set the tail wagging. I know when the silicone tail wags, the plug moves back and forth over the prostate and it can be very enjoyable. I've never been a pup, but I will say a tail plug can be kind of fun in the right circumstances. Does my obedient puppy like the feeling of his tail wagging? I say, laughing as the pup wiggles his pert ass at me. I take my time untying him, leaving the leash I used to secure him attached to the collar and leading him out of the room and down to the kitchen. I normally get sushi when I'm going to hand feed a pup, but it was far too late to get anything delivered, so I must make do with whatever I can find around the house. Luckily, Gretchen keeps my house stocked and ready for any eventuality, so I know there is some kind of cut fruit and some sliced meats in the fridge at the very least. I may have some leftovers that are still safe for human consumption. I can take care of myself, but I work crazy hours and part of the perks we provide to our employees is meals, so I normally grab dinner there or have something delivered. It's a good thing I'm a billionaire because I have expensive tastes. I take my time in the kitchen. I grab fruits and meats and cheeses along with some cookies from the pantry. My palate is snobby for most, but I thought the pup could find something he'll like in what I offered. I make a few bites of cheese and crackers and a few bites with more exotic things like figs and goat cheese. I need to eat, so if he doesn't like the stranger offerings, I'll eat them. I'm pleased with the pup as he follows me and waits for me to finish my random trips around the kitchen. It was shockingly easy to have him in my space. Every time I stop to think about something I want to grab, I pet him, and every time he leans into my hand. He's truly a touch-starved little thing. Heel puppy, let's go to the living room. I have a room for show, some ridiculous thing a designer insisted I have. The basement is the room I made to my specifications. The room has a huge couch and a TV that takes up an entire wall. There was a reason I started a tech company. I'm a nerd at heart. Sit by my feet. The puppy sits and leans into me as soon as I play with his hair. Maybe he wasn't the only one who could use human contact, I think, as I set the serving tray down beside me. I feed him simple things first, fruits by themselves, and then I start with the cheeses and offer the boy one of the fig and goat cheese things, finally pairing a piece of cantaloupe with a slice of prosciutto. The puppy moans like a whore when I give him the cantaloupe. I'm about to come in my pants like a fucking 12-year-old. The pup takes every opportunity to lick my fingers when I feed him. Anytime there is juice on my fingers, he licks and sucks and makes sure my hands are clean. It isn't the first time someone licked or sucked on my fingers as I was hand-feeding them, but with this boy there's no show, no calculation. He just did it, and God, it's all I can do not to grab him and start fucking him. I fed him a decent amount, so he didn't crash, but I don't think I've had such a hard time finishing a task since high school. The boy might be the death of me. Is my puppy ready to go back to the playroom?
Arf!
Good puppy, I say, as I grab his leash and lead him upstairs to the bedroom. Normally, with people I'm playing with, all of our play would stay in the playroom, but this boy I need to have in my bed. I've given up on trying to figure out why this boy is under my skin, he just is. Watching his tight ass as he climbs the stairs makes it hard not to lose all control and fuck him right there, and to hell with the consequences. My bed in the playroom has stairs to help a pup or someone crawling get on the bed, but since it was years since I let a sub or puppy who was a casual partner into my room, I'm going to have to lift him. When we get to the bed, I just push him up into the bed. It's unceremonious, but at least I get him up there with no trouble. Chapter 8. Jamie. Being hand-fed is something I'm going to have to do again. There is something so caring and amazing about having someone give you bites of food directly into your mouth. The food was odd, and some of it I don't even know what it is, but it all tasted delicious. Master gives me pets and kind words while he feeds me. At first, I allow myself to be fed, but the fuller I get, the more my dick reasserts its desires. I can't help myself, but I suck and lick at Sir's hand when he feeds me. It's so easy to turn my brain off and not think about anything other than the next bite of food and the sweet words and kind touches of my master. Malcolm is constantly talking, some things I can track, but mostly it's the calm voice and gentle strokes I focus on. This is like the time some counselor hypnotized me. I knew what was going on, but I could also relax and let everything become background noise. I want to sit here and not have to even think about getting the food to my mouth or when to eat next. It's just a bite and then pets and kind words and another bite. I think it's the most perfect moment of my life. I don't want to think. I want to enjoy the moment. Master made it perfect. When I feel like I'm about to come, I lick and suck on my daddy's fingers with every bite. I want him to finish feeding me and get onto the fucking, but I don't want to push. So, I go with trying to get his dick interested in what's going on with the hope we can go have sex. By the time I'm pushed onto the bed, I don't think I can wait another minute before this beautiful man has his cock in me. I don't even notice him messing with my tail until my hole is empty and longing for his magnificent cock.
Arf!
Does my puppy want my cock in his tail hole?
Arf! Arf! Arf!
Be still, puppy, so I can get my enormous cock lubed up and ready for you. I don't want to hurt you, little one.
Arf.
Good puppy. The feeling of my master spreading my ass apart to find my greedy hole brought me back to myself. Not that it hurts, because it doesn't, it's the way I wasn't thinking about anything other than his hands on my body. Now, though, I can't wait to feel his cock slide into my hole. You are such a well-behaved puppy. You do everything I ask of you. I am going to fuck you hard now and make you feel good. Malcolm. The pup is so hot waiting for me on all fours as I rub my cock over his gaping hole. I want to make it good for him, but I know I won't be able to last long without my cock buried in his perfect ass. He moans so prettily as I slide my cock in. I take a moment to let him adjust to my girth, but before I'm ready, the pup pushes back against me, moaning as he fucks himself on my cock. Be still, pup. I say, and push into him. The first time I bottom out, he comes, howling as he does. His ass is so tight, and the way he throws his head back and moans as I pound into him is intoxicating. I have one hand on his shoulder holding him in place, and the other hand I use to reach around his tight body and squeeze his nipples. I am trying to hold back and keep myself from coming, but he's so tight and his ass is still clenching around my cock from his orgasm. I barely last another 10 strokes before I release into the condom. God, I wish I could have fucked this perfect boy without a condom. I want to use my cum as lube as I slide my fingers into his gaping hole. I only hope he's too lost in his headspace to know what a piss poor fuck it is on my part. I take pride in being a good lay and making sure my partners enjoy themselves, but this wasn't my best work. He just had me so ready to go with the easy way he gave his submission to me. I can't wait to show the boy what I can do in the bedroom, but hopefully there will be many more chances. He came without me touching his cock, so he must have enjoyed it, but still, I normally provide a better performance. What a sweet puppy. You are so good. I can't believe I came so fast. You got me all worked up with your mouth while I was feeding you. Next time I'll use your perfect little hole in all kinds of ways, I say, and move the pup so he can lay, not in the wet spot, because I have some standards, and go grab a towel from the bathroom. I'll be right back, puppers. I'm just going to grab something to clean us both up. No one wants to wake up all sticky in the morning. I plan to command my pup to give me head in the morning before we get up, but there is sadism, and then there's making someone clean up dried cum from last night with their tongue. Sure, I can be sadistic, but even I draw the line somewhere, and cleaning up dry cum is a step too far. How is my puppy feeling?
Arf!
Does my puppy want to sleep in master's bed?
Arf, arf, arf.
Okay, my sweet boy. Let's get your mitts and knee pads off. I know getting him out of his headspace will be tricky, but at least I can make it so he can get some halfway decent sleep. Good night, daddy. What the fuck have I gotten myself into? This amazing boy just called me daddy. I've played with a little before, but daddy never felt right. With this boy, though, I want to be his daddy. Oh, what have I gotten myself into? I wrap my arms around my sweet boy, and less than a minute after I took my pup out of his gear, he curled up with his head on my chest. If I wasn't absolutely lost on him already, this would do it. Chapter 9. Jamie. Last night, when I was all blissed out and sleepy, calling Malcolm daddy seemed like the best idea in the world, but now in the harsh light of day, I want to crawl under the bed, vomit, and cry all at the same time. What was I thinking? I mean, sure, calling him daddy sounded good, and it felt amazing, but Jesus. I know I have a fucked up relationship with sex, but how can this not be a terrible dream? Oh my God, when am I going to wake up? I can climb out of bed and sneak out of the house. I have no idea where my bag with my phone ended up last night, and I don't think I can find it without waking him. And besides, it's one thing to do the walk of shame with a guy you will never see again, but he's my boss. How the fuck do you hide from your boss? Maybe he didn't hear me. I can pretend I didn't say it and we can go on like we were. As much as I loved last night, I would settle for never playing with him again if we can go on like nothing ever happened. What the fuck was I thinking? I resist the urge to bury my head in my hands and shake my head in shame. I mean, I know the problem. I wasn't thinking. If I were thinking, I would have never called him daddy in the first place. How could I be so dumb? Oh, my God. I mean, I have seen movies where the girl says, I love you, like a month into knowing the guy, and I always cringed for the person who said it, but shit, now that poor unfortunate person is me. Living out that fucked up stupid moment in Technicolor rainbows. Big A, good night daddy rainbows. Fuck my life. Malcolm. For me, waking up is not gradual. It's been a while since I've woken up next to someone. I have plenty of sex partners and plenty of play partners, but even the ones who come to my home and spend the night often sleep in the guest room or the playroom. Basil slept in my bed a few times, but since they lived with me, they normally slept in their bed and not with me. But the boy is here wrapped around me. As I notice more about the boy, though, I can see what woke me. He's stiff as a board. I'm not sure what turned the soft, sleepy, tousle-haired boy who went to bed with me last night into this stressed-out and ready-to-run-for-the-hills young man, but something happened. He's not okay. I'm betting it's the daddy thing. I wouldn't push him to call me that ever, and it was a bit jarring to hear, but I can see the draw for the kid to age play or even just want a daddy-slash-boy relationship, and I've known several puppies who called their handler daddy. The boy was the caretaker for his parents, so having someone be in charge and take care of him would appeal. I saw his need for it in the club. I thought he would be satisfied with pet play and other types of D/S play, but if he wants to call me daddy, I'm all for it. I want to take care of the boy and give him whatever he wants. Running my hand down his back, I talk to him. You're okay. I lean into the daddy thing, deciding that letting him know I'm okay with him calling me daddy or seeing me in that way is fine with me. Daddy thinks you are the sweetest and cutest puppy ever. Daddy had so much fun playing with you last night. I couldn't believe how fast I came. Petting the boy's back as I talk seems to help because he's calming down and getting increasingly pliant under my hand. I wonder if he's fallen asleep. His breathing has evened out and he's calm and relaxed under my hand. I'm sorry, his soft words sound dejected and lost. He's acting like a puppy who's been kicked one too many times for trying to get petted. I can't help but want to make everything better for him. Do you think I'm mad at you for calling me daddy? I'm not new to the daddy/boy dynamic. I'm honored you feel like I should be your daddy so soon. I'm really not mad. I'm happy to have a cute little boy like you to play with. His muscles are fully relaxed now. Why don't we get up and shower and we can talk over breakfast? I think you might be sub-dropping, and sugar will make you feel less lost and upset. I'm not saying you don't have the right to feel how you feel. I just think you might not feel so distraught if you have some food in you. Jamie. When I say the bathroom is as big as my apartment, I might exaggerate, but not by much. The tub is big enough that both Malcolm and I could get in and still have room to move around. You could have a party and still be underwater. And that isn't considering the shower with two heads and a rain shower and crotch misters. You could easily have three people there and never get cold. I'm still on the verge of a panic attack, but the bathroom is making my brain short circuit a little. And Malcolm followed me here. I thought when he told me to get cleaned up it was going to be a solo adventure, but it seems Malcolm isn't dumb. I would have lost my cool the minute the door shut behind me. Just like last night, Daddy knows what I need and is making sure I get it. I need to piss, and yet when I walk to the toilet, Daddy tells me to stand where I am next to him at the shower while he turns it on and sets it to the right temperature. I have the faintest memories of my dad giving me a bath when I was little, but it wasn't something he did often, and it was always about getting clean and getting out of there. Malcolm keeps petting and touching me while he fiddles with the water. Now that the water is running, my bladder makes sure I know I need to piss. When I try to walk away, Daddy grabs my shoulder, stopping me. It's the first thing in the morning, he knows I need to piss. Everyone needs to piss in the morning, and yet he's making me wait. I have to go, I say, knowing I'm doing the pee-pee dance as I stand there listening to the water run. What the fuck is going on that he won't let me pee? If you hold it until after the shower, I'll give you a reward. I don't know what the reward is, but I know I want it. Somehow Daddy knew exactly what to do to keep me from freaking out because I am totally focused on needing to pee and doing what it requires to get my reward. I'm no longer in panic mode. You are going to let Daddy wash you. If you can follow instructions, you will get a reward, but you can't get punished for this. Daddy is playing a game, but there is no punishment, just getting a reward or not getting a reward. Okay? I'm shocked as Daddy steps into the shower, pulling me after him. The shower feels more amazing than I thought it was going to feel when I saw it, but what is better is that Daddy runs his hands up and down my back. When he reaches for the shampoo, he presses his chest against my back. His cock is rock hard pressed into my ass, but it's not demanding or even sexual. It's the way he's holding me I can't seem to get over. Daddy is taking care of me and I love it. I can almost put the need to pee out of my mind if I focus on what Daddy's doing. Rinse, Daddy says, stepping away from me as I rinse the shampoo out of my hair. Before I can mourn the loss of my daddy for too long, he's back and his entire body presses to mine as he reaches for the bath gel. He grabs the scrubby and washes my back and arms, dropping to his knees to wash my legs and feet. It would be erotic if he wasn't so focused on getting me clean. His face is inches from my cock, but he's washing me with such care. I've showered with hookups before, but even when they washed my back, it never felt like this. Daddy skips my whole genital region. I want to get upset, but I can do what I did last night when he put my gear on and just let him move me where he wants me. Soon Daddy is washing my chest and has his arms wrapped around me from behind, holding me to his muscular body as he scrubs my chest. I feel so warm and comforted as he holds me with one hand and washes me with the other. His soapy hand is washing my cock and balls, and as much as I want to get hard at him touching my cock and washing my balls, it brings my need to pee to the center of my mind. I don't know if I pee a little or if Daddy is just a Jedi Master, but suddenly I hear Daddy talking and it's no longer the calm sweet words it was before. Don't pee until I tell you to. Daddy wants you to be a good boy and to hold it. Only bad doggies pee before their daddy tells them. Be my good boy and keep holding it. We're almost done. As Daddy speaks, he stops washing me and wraps his arms around my abdomen, putting his arms around my bladder and squeezing me as he nibbles on my neck. Don't pee, pupper, or it will disappoint Daddy. I want to make Daddy proud, so I do my best to hold it while he squeezes me and nuzzles my neck. I really have to piss. The words have barely left my mouth when Daddy squeezes me so tightly, I think I might explode. My bladder is burning and I'm trying my best to flex my abs so Daddy can't push on bladder, but I'm failing and it hurts so bad. I remember a road trip as a kid when my dad drove past the last gas station before we crossed the mountains and I had to pee so bad before we got to the next place we could stop, but that doesn't hold a candle to how badly I have to pee as Daddy squeezes me now. Is that how you ask your daddy something? No, I'm sorry, Daddy. I didn't mean to, I just have to go. I can't hold it. I want to be good, but I'm losing it here. As I talk, Daddy's grip loosens, and I feel ever so slightly better before Daddy's hand is holding my cock. It's not sexual. He's holding it the way I would hold it if I were going to piss in a toilet. Daddy is going to hold your pee-pee while you tinkle. I can't, Daddy. I can't go while you watch me, and I can't go while you hold my dick. I know better than to use that word even before Daddy is squeezing my bladder again, but I couldn't help it. The words just came out. I have always had a bashful bladder, so there's no way I'm going to go like this. You don't have to do anything, you just have to do what I say. And I say you will pee like this with me holding it, or you will hold it until you cry. I don't know if it's a minute or 20 minutes, but suddenly I can't hold it anymore. It hurts so much, and Daddy is pressing so hard on my bladder. I just can't make myself let go. I know it hurts, but you are hurting yourself. I will stop squeezing you as soon as you go. Just let Daddy take care of you. Be a good boy for Daddy. Let Daddy take care of you. Be my sweet, precious boy and just let go. As soon as you go potty, we'll get out and dry off and have breakfast. Daddy will make you whatever you want for breakfast. Do you want French toast or pancakes? Bacon and eggs? All you have to do is let Daddy take care of you. I don't mean to start peeing, but somewhere between pancakes and let Daddy take care of you, I start to pee. Daddy doesn't move, he just holds me and tells me how good I am and how proud he is of me. Chapter 10. Malcolm. God, I thought for a minute, it was too much for my boy. Asking him to pee while I held his cock for him, but I can't let him win if he doesn't safe word out of the scene. He just wouldn't let go. From the moment I woke up, it was clear he was on the verge of panic. I thought his slip into calling me daddy was cute, but the boy thought it was a terrible thing. I get that for some people peeing in front of a partner is a hard limit, but the way he's acting and how much his mind spins, I think his trepidation is about what happened last night as much as what happened this morning. I have played daddy for several boys and pups in the past, both age players and subs who wanted a daddy and not a dom, but I've never been around a little boy or girl who was figuring out they wanted a daddy. Daddy isn't my go-to honorific with a sub, so when people have called me daddy, it was something they were into and we discussed it first. I have never had a sub just do it out of instinct. I think this sweet puppy did it without thinking. He was out of it when it happened last night. I hope pushing him to trust me in this way will help him see I'm not freaked out and I will take care of him. He's such a sweet boy and I want him to feel taken care of. He needs someone in his corner, and if he's willing to allow, it'll be me. My little puppy fights so valiantly to keep from doing what I ask. It was about all I could do not to fuck him at the way he whimpers and whines when I squeeze him. I just want him to trust that daddy will take care of him no matter what he thinks. I can tell he has never had someone really take care of him, and if me offering these minor acts of caretaking is what it takes to make my boy feel safe, I will do it. Holding him as he cries is an intense moment for me. I have made many subs cry for many reasons, but not from something so small. All he had to do was trust me. It was clear he doesn't trust easily. I want to hold him forever, but my water heater is only so big, and the water is cooling. Climbing out of the shower with the boy clinging to me is a bit of a challenge, but I get it done. Thank God I spent a stupid amount of money on that damn towel warmer, because the way he relaxes ever so slightly more at the warm towel I wrap around him has my heart melting all over again. What did my sweet boy think of peeing in front of daddy? I know the question might upset him more, but I must get the boy talking so we can really look at what happened last night and figure out why he's so stressed about calling me daddy. I know it's a huge leap for him. Hell, it's a tremendous leap for most people, but this boy seems to need to figure out what he wants. The only way to accomplish that is to talk. Does my boy want to get something to eat? I'm starving and bet you'll feel better after you have something in your stomach, I say, sounding calm and joyful to make the boy see I'm not anything but thrilled with him. It seems to work because he melts into me as I dry him. Food sounds good. The words sound steadier than they did before, but the boy still doesn't seem to be on solid ground. We'll have to talk, and hopefully I can show him I'm ecstatic to have him as my boy. As much as I want to walk to the playroom and grab a pair of footy pajamas I have stashed away for when my play partner is feeling the need to be little, I hold off. We need to talk, and he needs to see this can be okay and not scary. But this boy will look so cute in the puppy footy jams I have in the closet. He's such a puppy and a little, I think he will love them no matter what headspace he's in. I will be good, though, and not push before we talk about last night and this morning. Come get dressed for daddy, I say, grabbing a pair of lounge pants and a t-shirt the boy will swim in. I can't deny I love putting any of my partners in my clothes, but especially when they are too big for them and they look like they're dressing up in daddy's clothes. Fuck, I'm more of a daddy than I thought. I love playing with littles, but I also love to play harder with my partners. Some littles like to play hard, but a vast number of them don't like to play too hard and like to keep their play to more domination and control than pain. Hell, I don't even know if the boy will like pain play, it isn't like he's ever tried it before. Sure, he's seen it at the club, but there's a world of difference between seeing and experiencing. I'll just have to be happy with him in my clothes and wait to see if I can play dress up with him later. Jamie. If he told me he was going to make me pee while he held my cock, I would have said no. There was something about having my daddy hold my pee-pee for me while I pissed that was fantastic. It was hard. How could it not be when he was holding my dick and wrapped around me telling me what a good boy I was? He was right though, I felt safe, like my daddy would take care of me. It was like last night when he was petting me and feeding me. I could just relax and not have to worry about things beyond what my daddy was telling me to do. All I had to do was follow instructions and daddy would make all the decisions and take care of me. He would make sure I ate enough. There is something different about having your basic needs taken care of, that's different from any other kind of care. Even if someone took all your choices, you would still have to think about if you ate and what you ate and when you were full and if you needed to pee, and daddy showed me he could make those choices for me too, and I loved it. I would hate it if we did that all the time, but occasionally, I could see the appeal. I feel like I should rebel against him making those choices for me. That I should give him pushback and assert my autonomy, but I honestly don't want to. I want to sink into letting daddy decide what we'll eat for breakfast and if I get seconds and what I should wear. I want to give those choices to my daddy and let him take care of me. Growing up, it wasn't like my dad did any of those things. If I wanted seconds or to not eat my dinner, my dad never cared much. It was easier to let me do what I wanted than to fight with me about stuff like that. So, if what I was doing wouldn't hurt me or get CPS involved, he didn't care. I decided what I would wear and what to eat from the time I was 3 or 4. I want to sink into letting daddy make those choices for me in the way my dad never did. I follow daddy down to the kitchen and he must be able to tell I'm lost in my own mind because he doesn't ask me what I want for breakfast. He just walks around the space and starts pulling things out. I feel like I should help, but I can't seem to make myself move, and again daddy must sense it because he walks up and wraps me in a tight hug. What a good boy you are. Do you want to help daddy cook or do you want to watch? I try to answer, but I can't seem to make the words come out. As I stand there feeling increasingly lost, daddy takes my hand leading me to the island and pulls a chair out for me. Sit, sweet boy, and I'll make us food and we can talk. I'm going to make French toast, so I'll be done soon. Will my little buddy be okay while I cook? Yes, daddy, I say. The words sound high and childish to my own ears, but I don't have to make choices. All I must do is follow the instructions daddy gave me. Malcolm. I didn't think he was going to be a little. I knew he was a puppy, but I thought he would be more my boy than my little boy, but he seems to fall extremely hard into whatever headspace he's going to be in. I'm not trying to push him to be little while I'm making breakfast, but he seems to easily fall into wanting me to give him directions, and I'm loving it. I'll have to pull him out at least enough so we can talk, but I'm looking forward to spending the day with my boy. I make enough food for at least 4 people, but the boy looks like he could use a delicious meal. Our snack last night wasn't exactly a meal, so I made a big plate of French toast sticks for us to eat. It's more work to make, but I figure the boy will enjoy either being fed again or like dunking them and chomping on them. My little niece loves when I make her French toast into sticks so she can hold them in her hands and dunk them. My sister was my best friend growing up, and while we aren't as close as we once were, I still love her and have her and her daughter in my home often. My sweet boy tucks into his French toast with such excitement it warms my heart to see him so happy. When we talk about what age play was and what other littles get out of age play, Jamie realizes he's both a pup and a little, but more a little than a pup. I thought he would be more pup, but when we talk, he's extremely excited about regressing and having a daddy to really take care of him. Chapter 11. Jamie. Talking to daddy was amazing. There are so many things I didn't know were options before, and I want to try them all. I love being daddy's puppy last night, but I can't wait to try out being his little boy. Sitting with daddy while we eat, he takes care of me, and it's amazing. I can feel the way I'm smiling as I eat my French toast sticks. I've never had them like this, not even from a drive-thru. I can't wait to do it again. There's something so exciting about turning a non-finger food into a finger food. I love it. Part of me hopes I won't have to try it again by myself. Maybe daddy will make them for me in the future. Will you make chickens in a basket for me? I don't realize I'm speaking until it's out of my mouth, but I can't see anything more pressing than finding out at this moment if he will make them for me. What are chickens in a basket? He asks, laughing as he speaks. You know when you cut a hole in a piece of bread and then fry an egg in the hole? Oh, you mean an egg in a hole? Yes, my sweet boy, I will make you chickens in a basket. I can feel myself smile at the way I'll be getting my chickens in a basket. That was one of the few things my mom would do when I wasn't feeling well. She would make those for me. I don't remember her cooking anything else. Hell, for all I know, that could be the only thing she knew how to make. Even now when I don't feel well, I'll make them for myself. Now Daddy says he'll make them for me. Thanks, Daddy, I mumble as I shove another bite of my French toast into my mouth. When I've eaten the whole plate of food, I can't help but rub my belly. I wasn't hungry when I sat, but when the food was in front of me and Daddy was talking, I couldn't help but just keep eating. Now I want Daddy to rub my tummy and let me nap on the couch. Daddy, you mentioned you had clothes for me to wear when I'm little? Yes, my little buddy, do you want to go take a look? Uh-huh, I say, not able to stifle my yawn as I talk. The clothes are amazing. Daddy must have another boy. The thought makes me unutterably sad, but I push the thought away and stand in front of the closet and look through the items. Daddy and I talked about diapers, and while I'm curious about trying them, I know I need time to enjoy being Daddy's boy before we try diapers. There was something exciting about the idea of diapers, but not something I want to try right now. I want to enjoy having Daddy take care of me. When we talked about options, Daddy mentioned that I could stay here. I don't think he liked the idea of me living in an Airbnb. He's protective already. I want to say that's a red flag and run away, but the idea of living here in this amazing house with a daddy who takes care of me is too good to give up. As much as I want to pick the jammies, I'm so exhausted by everything that's happened in the past day that I just want my daddy to pick out my clothes and take the choice away. At least for now. Malcolm. My sweet boy looks so lost looking at choices for what he wants to wear. I wanted him to pick, but it's too much for him. Do you want Daddy to pick? Yes, Daddy, he says, his face looking so relieved at having the choice taken away from him. My heart feels like it might burst with the euphoria of the moment. I pick the pair of footy jammies with the rainbow-colored paw prints on them. They are extremely cute, and he'll look adorable in them. My boy is even cuter than I thought he would be in the jammies. I'm going to have to do some shopping. I have a few things for littles, but some items you just don't share. If I'm honest with myself, I want to spoil the boy. Few enough people are ever spoiled the way they should be, but especially this boy. He's clearly never really been adored. Come, little one. Let's go to the TV room and I'll put on a movie and we can cuddle. I know I'm being a simp, but I can't help it when it comes to this boy. The boy follows me like the best behaved puppy ever. I wonder how much of his behavior is puppy and how much is little. Lots of littles like to be puppies. I enjoy obedience and I am by no means a brat tamer, but it's like the boy has no spark. My heart hurts to think of how an 18-year-old could be so beaten down already. I don't want an ill-behaved boy, but I want him to show some signs of life. I'll have to push him and see if I can get him to push back and show me some sort of fire. As soon as I sit, the boy is on the couch. He manages to curl up into an impossibly tiny ball and wedge himself into the far end of the couch from where I'm sitting. It's yet more evidence that even in this headspace he's guarded and doing his best to protect himself. I turn on the TV and get everything set to watch something on Netflix. I keep hoping he'll come over to me on his own. I don't want him to think he has to cuddle if he doesn't want to, but by the time I've got the land before time up and ready to start and he still hasn't given any sign of coming over to me, I give up. Do you want to come and sit by me? The words have barely left my mouth before the boy is scurrying to come cuddle with me. He's not big, but he's still managing to end up tucked up under my arm and half in my lap. The boy is too cute, and I can't help but wrap my arm around him so I can hold him tightly. I'm not a little, but I love this movie. It was always a favorite when I was a child, so I've seen it more than enough times to be able to follow the movie without really paying attention. I take the opportunity to pull up my work email on my phone and review some things. It's Saturday, but there's always something going on at the office. Like most weekends, I have work that needs to be done. Normally, I enjoy working on the weekends, but for some reason today my workaholic nature is frustrating to me. It's the boy in my arms that has me wanting to focus on him and not my work. My manager of HR, Lathan, will be so pleased. He found a slave about a year ago and has been pushing all of us to settle down since then. Before today, I thought it was him wanting to meddle, but now I see for the first time that I really was missing something. I had play partners who were either gone in the morning or not engaging enough to hold my attention. I can't wait to have Lathan tell me what a fool I've been when he sees me on Monday. After the fifth time I get distracted by something, I give up on working and start browsing my favorite sites for littles. I'll have to ask if the boy has some preferences, but there are things I'll make decisions on. I'll put some other options in the cart and let him look them over before I buy them. I pick out more than 10 onesies and twice as many pairs of fun cartoon underwear. The boy is muscular but still lithe enough I think he can wear actual kids' items. That opens the door to so many more designs and fun things than you can find on adult-sized kids' underwear. For some unknown reason, Disney just will not license their products for adult little sites. He mentioned he likes comic books, so I buy some things for the boy on Amazon. What is the point of being rich if you can't spoil the people in your life? The number of sippy cups and plates and other items for my boy is staggering, but I want him to have choices. He mentioned that he's been staying at an Airbnb and I'd like to have him somewhere safer. I figure if things go well this weekend, I'll ask him to move in next week. Normally I wouldn't want to put that kind of pressure on a boy, but it's not like he has a lease he couldn't replace in short order. Somehow, I didn't even notice when he fell asleep. He's snoring softly and clinging to me. I turn the TV down a little and go back to shopping. I run my fingers through his blonde hair as I put yet more things into my shopping cart. By the time the movie's over, I've managed to spend over 10 grand and I still have some things in the cart that I want him to decide on. Jamie. Waking up was so easy this time. Daddy was still holding me and playing with my hair. It was what I always wanted from my bio dad. The difference from this morning is staggering. This morning waking up meant facing what I had said last night. Waking now safe in my daddy's arms is like coming home. I'm not naive enough to be in love yet, but I'm firmly in like, and better yet, I felt safe. Sure, last night was amazing. I got to be a puppy, something I never thought I would enjoy, but today cuddled up with my daddy is something special. I can't believe I'm this lucky. I can't completely ignore the fact that at some point he'll be done playing with his new toy and send me away. Fuck, that sounded dramatic to me, but Daddy had a life, and he won't want some basically homeless kid living with him. I could be fun for a night, but that's all I'll ever be to a man like this. I could be fun on a regular basis, but I'll never be the kind of guy someone like Malcolm White would be with. He is the son of a senator. His family wasn't rich like he is, but they'll want him to be with some well-respected man who knows what fork to eat with. I'm not a hooker, but taking me somewhere fancy would still be like Julia Roberts trying to have dinner with Richard Gere and Pretty Woman. Stop thinking. What? It sounds fragile and stupid to my own ears. God, what must I sound like to Daddy? I said stop thinking. I think your ears are about to start smoking. What has you thinking so hard over there? I was, the desire to cry and hide my face in Daddy's chest is strong. I already felt like a failure he wouldn't want, but now it all feels like too much. Strong arms pull me, so I'm now fully sitting in Daddy's lap, my hips snugged against his belly. I can't help but hide my face in his neck. Tears start rolling down my cheeks, and I know Daddy can feel I'm crying. My whole body is shaking, and his shirt is getting wet. Talk to me, buddy. Tell me what has you so upset? The words are calm and soft, and I can almost believe Daddy wants me for more than a toy, but he is everything I will never be, rich, powerful, from a good family. Please talk to me, I just want to know what's wrong. I'm not good enough for you. I can't help thinking that you'll get bored with me. That you only want to play with me because I'm new. When the newness wears off, you won't want me anymore. I was going to wait to ask you this until we've played a few more times, but I think you need to hear it now. I want you to move in with me. I haven't met anyone in more than a decade that I wanted to have in my life as more than a casual play partner, but you've managed to get past all my defenses. I was going to ask you to move in since you're staying in an Airbnb and God knows I have the room. I'm not sure what I thought he was going to say, but asking me to move in with him wasn't what I expected at all. I thought he might offer some hollow statement to placate me, but his words sounded so sincere. This hard man managed to let me into his heart and wants me to stay. It's a dream come true for someone like me. It isn't the fact that this man could make my life easier that I'm so excited about. It's the fact that he wants me around. He wants me in his life and in his space. Really? I must sound like a dick, but that just popped out. I know he's not playing some game with me, but I had to ask. Daddy managed to get under my skin. I know it's too soon to use the word love, but something about the safety I feel with him is so compelling. Yes, my sweet boy. I want you here. We'll figure out how that will work, and if you want to stay employed at the club or if you want to work for me here. I have a full-time personal assistant, and as my boy you can do those things, or you can keep your job at the club and just be my boy when you want to play. I think I would like to be your personal assistant. I've seen some porn where the person cooks and cleans and does chores around the house, and I think I would like that kind of arrangement. I know the boy is probably too young to have seen the secretary, but I can't help thinking about his perfect ass bent over my desk as I spank him in a spreader bar collar. I have a home office and spreader bar just like in the movie. What rich dom doesn't have one so they can act that scene out? Okay, my sweet boy. Do you want to go get your things? Yes. Chapter 12. 3 months later. Jamie. The music blares from the speakers in the kitchen. It's my favorite song and I can't help dancing and swinging my hips as I move through the kitchen. I always loved cooking as a kid, but now that I have time and money for ingredients, it's quickly becoming one of my favorite things. After I moved in with Daddy, I started working less at the club. I still work there, but now it's only on the nights they need the extra help. For the past few weeks since they hired Jack, I haven't worked at all. I thought I would hate being so dependent on Daddy, but I feel like I'm earning my keep. Daddy was paying his personal assistant a crazy amount of money, so having Daddy pay me to do chores isn't as weird as I thought it would be. At first, I felt like a hooker, but I work hard. Daddy's always busy, and I have a lot to do. His last PA didn't do the cooking. She made sure there was food in house, but she didn't really cook. He ate most of his meals at work. Now he says he has something he wants to come home to, so I cook. The house proved to be too much for me to clean on my own. I didn't realize he had two full-time cleaning people when I insisted I could take care of the house on my own. Telling Daddy I couldn't keep up was a huge step for us. I hadn't realized Daddy knew I couldn't do it. Well, that wasn't exactly true, but if you can't lie to yourself, who can you lie to? Daddy told me I should let him keep the cleaning people. He told me over and over that being his PA and taking care of the other things around the house like cooking was too much for one person, but I wouldn't listen. I wanted to earn my keep and I tried. God, had I tried. When I finally told Daddy I just couldn't keep the house up and that I hadn't cleaned the rooms we didn't use in almost a month, I cried. I begged for his forgiveness and Daddy just scooped me up into his arms and said, "Thank God you finally told me. I knew it wasn't possible for you to manage everything, but I didn't want to make you feel like you were a disappointment. I wanted you to trust my feelings for you enough that you could come to me with this." Daddy held me for a long time and then paddled my ass for waiting so long. I couldn't sit comfortably for a week. He told me that I wasn't being punished for failing, but for not telling him when something was too much for me. I somehow managed to assume I was there to serve him. I mean, I am. But it wasn't until that moment that I really understood I had power in the relationship. Sure, Daddy pays the bills and Daddy is the dom, but I have power and more, I have responsibility to myself and him. That was a hard lesson. I'm still having a hard time accepting that I don't have to earn my place in Daddy's life. I work as his PA because he needs a PA and I genuinely enjoy serving him. But I don't have to serve Daddy to be worthy of his love. One of his hardest rules was going to therapy. I hate that it was a condition of living with him. I understand it and I love him so much for making me go, but I hate that he could see how broken I am and made it a condition of being with him. My therapist is amazing. Jane is in the lifestyle and understands our dynamic, but she makes me explore things I don't want to look at. My father, being who he is, left me with scars, and my mother leaving gave me abandonment issues. I'm learning, at least in theory, that I'm not broken and that I'm worthy of being loved. Mostly when I have therapy, I come home sad and a little lost, but today was good. Normally on therapy days dinner is simple and if we play, I get to retreat into my little space and have daddy take care of me with lots of cuddles. Today was a therapy day but it wasn't bad, and I want to have a fun evening with daddy. Even though I have a lot of work to do for daddy on a regular basis, I have time in my day to watch cooking shows. While some of the things I watch are simple tasty food, I enjoy some of the super hard recipes. I'm making a prime rib next week for daddy and the other owners of Crash. I found out that they have a cook-off at the holiday party every year and daddy says I can submit something for the taste testing as well. I've gotten to meet the guys who make up most of management from Crash and they're interesting. Great guys, but interesting. They're mostly single and all kinky. I thought they would hate me and judge me for where I came from, but they didn't. They've welcomed me and seem glad that I make daddy happy. Malcolm. I've fallen so in love with my boy, it's astounding. We have an amazing dynamic. I knew we would have a great dynamic before I even played with him, but what I didn't know was how the rest of who we are would mesh. My boy fits with me and he fits in my life. It wasn't all sunshine and roses, but it was so much better than I thought it'd be. After my ex, I never thought I would have someone in my life again, but this boy has wiggled his way into my heart. Most nights he cooks dinner. I'm not so heartless to force him after he worked all day, but he loves taking care of me and I enjoy being taken care of. He does so much around the house that I'm too busy to do. Normally, I have to be reminded to leave work even with my boy waiting on me to come home and spoil him. I'm still a workaholic, but after his text telling me he had a surprise for me, I can't wait to get home. I'd leave early if I didn't think he'd be stressed out by me coming home and interrupting his dinner plans. Most nights after his therapy, we see what happens, but he had a good session and wants to play tonight. We talked about a specific scene we were both interested in trying, and he told me he wants to do it tonight. I can't wait. My cock is standing at attention just thinking about it. My drive home is a lesson in self-control. How I managed to keep the car under 100 is beyond me. I just can't wait to get home and play with my puppy. Tonight is going to be a lot of fun. Parking in the garage, I check my email on my phone, taking my time to make sure my puppy has time to think about the night to come. My puppy knows he needs to be waiting for me on his knees in his pup hood and gear by the door when I come through the door. Everything in me wants to rush in and start playing with my boy, but having him wait for me will add to his anticipation, and I do love to give my pup what he likes. After what has to be the longest 10 minutes of my life, I walk to the door and let myself in. Somehow, I'm surprised to see my boy looking perfect there in his mitts and collar and hood. The only thing missing is his tail. I love to put my puppy's tail in for him when we play, and I guess he wanted to let me have the fun of putting it in for him tonight. I ignore my boy and walk into the dining room where there is the most perfect meal for one laid out on the table. The only thing keeping this from looking like a 5-star dinner service is the dog bed by the table with a plate next to it. Normally with a meal like this, I would enjoy a glass of wine, but I want a clear head for my night with my puppy.
Come!
The word has barely left my mouth when I hear him scrambling up the 4 stairs into the kitchen and into the dining room. He's carrying the largest tail plug I have in his mouth as he rounds the corner and skids to a stop, not getting on the cushion yet. Does my boy want daddy to put his tail in before dinner? When I look at the wet bar, I see that he's placed the lube there for me to see when I make my drink. I can't help but smile at his clear desire to have his daddy fill his hole tonight. What a good boy you are. Normally I can hide what I'm feeling when I play with someone, but I can't hide my tender feelings for this boy.
Arf!
I see you're ready for me to put your tail in. Are you sure we shouldn't wait until after dinner? You made such a nice meal, I can't help but think your poor little tail hole will get sore if we leave that big tail in you until after dinner. I'm pretty sure he won't back out on this evening, but I want to give him the option to stop things if he wants to. We've never played with this tail because it's so big, but my puppy wants me to fist him tonight, so we're going to see how he does with the tail plug before I try my fist.
Arf!
How the boy manages to make a bark sound sad is beyond me, but he does. Okay, sweet boy. Get on your bed with your head down and tail up and daddy will put this in for you. God, his ass is too perfect, and the little shit knows it. He makes sure to put his ass up facing me while I grab the lube and wash my hands. He's trembling when I stroke his back, but he seems so eager, I'm sure it's anticipation and not nerves. Running my well-lubed fingers around his tight little rosebud, I can feel him push back against my finger. Clearly my boy is ready for me to get on with it. I circle his hole a few times and then I start working in one finger. I've used my pup's hole almost every night for 3 months and I know how much prep he needs, so I quickly move on to two fingers. For just a moment he tightens up and then he relaxes again. I'm back to pushing in my fingers as I start to scissor them and stretch him open. Jamie. I can't believe tonight's the night daddy is going to fist me for the first time. It's something I've always wanted to explore. I had a boyfriend in high school try, but that didn't go well. I know my daddy has a thing for big toys and fisting and I want to do this with him. I trust daddy to make tonight enjoyable for me. When the third finger goes in it hurts, but not bad. I can hear daddy talking to me and that's all I need to help me relax. Every few strokes daddy hits my prostate just right and I can't help but shiver and whine. I know better than to talk unless I need a safe word, but daddy is amazing and takes me right to the edge of coming and then backs off. I must sound like a whore moaning and rocking back into daddy's hand as he preps me for the toy, but I can hear daddy's words sounding less and less coherent, a sign he's enjoying this as much as I am. All too soon my greedy hole is empty, and I can't stop myself from whining and yipping at the loss. Be a good boy and stay still, I just need to grab the tail and I will get that slutty hole all filled back up. Breathe for me and try to relax. The toy starts small, but it gets bigger quickly, and I can feel the burn as he pushes it deeper. I must have whimpered because daddy is talking again and telling me I can take the toy and how proud he is of me for letting him fill my hole with something so big. Just when I think I can't take it, I feel it pop in place. As soon as it's fully in me, daddy's sitting next to me and rubbing my back while I get used to the size. I've had bigger toys, but they were only after daddy had stretched me really well and fucked my tail hole. But as I lay here, I can feel the burn subsiding. All too soon, daddy's gone and sitting in the chair in front of me. Oh, what a pretty, pretty boy you are with your big tail in for me. I'm so proud of you for taking that like a good boy. Now you get two choices. Daddy will hand feed you the amazing dinner you made for us, but you have to sit up like a good puppy and put your cute little ass on the cushion no matter how uncomfortable the tail makes you. Or you can stand up and eat the fast food I bought. It's already cold and you'll have to go stand in the kitchen and eat alone while I sit here and enjoy the beautiful meal you made for me. The idea of having to eat cold leftover fast food alone in the kitchen makes me want to cry and I rush to move around, so I'm sitting on the cushion. I can feel the stretch of the tail in my ass already, and it's only just started. I'll be in agony before dinner is over, but it's worth it to be here with daddy. Every couple of minutes daddy will hand feed me a bite of this or that. He takes the time to wipe my mouth when I need and pet my head as he tells me about his day. I'm not really trying to track the story, I just enjoy having his voice wash over me as he feeds me. Ever since that first night, having Malcolm hand feed me is one of my favorite things. I love being taken care of in that way. My ass is killing me, but I can manage to drift and focus on the way daddy pets my hair or the way he uses his thumb to wipe a crumb off my lip. I must have been wiggling because the next thing I know daddy is clipping on the leash leading me to the stairs. Somehow going up the stairs manages to stretch my hole because all of a sudden, I can't ignore the way my ass feels anymore, and I just want daddy to fix it and make it stop hurting so much. There is a good burn and stretch and then there is agony, and as I'm climbing the stairs it's moving to agony. Yip, 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 I whine as we climb the stairs. Daddy bends over and lifts me into a bridal carry and puts me on the bed in the playroom. Laying me on my back and rubbing my belly as he talks to me. Now that I'm not moving, it hurts much less and it's quickly going back to slight discomfort from the agony of before. I can relax back into my floaty place as daddy moves around the room. I can hear him talking, so I know where he is and what he's doing. The bed dips and then daddy is moving me around, so I'm on the swing. Sometimes dating a literal billionaire is amazing. The sex swing has pulleys so you can be laying on the bed and he can slide the swing under you and then use the pulley to get you up off the bed so you are fully in the swing and you don't have to stress about trying to get in or out of the swing when you are all floaty and loose-limbed from an amazing fucking. When I'm in the swing, my bottom down with my legs held up in the foot straps and my hole is fully on display, daddy starts playing with the plug. I just about come when he flicks the tail, sending vibrations into my prostate as the silicone wags back and forth. The smile on daddy's face says he knows exactly what that did to me. He starts to fuck the tail in and out of my hole, smiling as it tugs on that ring of muscle, reminding me that while he stretched me to get the plug in my ass, the base is much narrower, and I have gotten used to the narrower part and not the largest part of the toy. He pushes the toy in and then ever so slightly out, making my ass stretch as he does. When I feel like it's too much, he forces the toy back in and makes sure to rub it against my prostate, keeping me somewhere between agony and ecstasy. As he fucks me with the toy, he pulls it just a little farther out with every thrust, making the pain a little worse with each stroke. When the toy reaches its apex, I whine and can't help but thrash around. It feels like the toy is ripping me apart. It's almost too much pain, but part of me wants there to be more of the stretch and pain. It's so arousing and exciting to be stretched like so completely. Suddenly, daddy pulls the toy out of my ass, and for a moment I want to scream at the stretch, but then I want to scream at how empty I feel. Over the past 3 months, daddy has put so many things in my ass, and there is always a loss when they are removed, but tonight it all seems to be too much for me to be empty. I want to cry at the pain, but I also want to beg daddy to fill my hole and make the emptiness go away. Before I can get too upset at being empty, daddy is sliding his fingers into my gaping hole. Daddy has managed to get 4 fingers in me before, but never past the knuckles. You are doing so well for daddy. I have all 4 fingers in you and I'm ready to push my knuckles into you. I can't believe how well you're doing. I know it hurts, but you are so good and so brave for daddy. In a minute, I'm going to push my knuckles into you. Are you ready? Arf, 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 I bark as he pushes his knuckles into me. It hurts so much, but I feel so owned by daddy and he hasn't even gotten the biggest part into me yet. Now daddy is rubbing my prostate with all 4 fingers and he twists his hand inside. I don't even realize I'm crying until daddy uses his other hand to pull my hood off. It's the most amazing feeling to be so full and to have my daddy looking at me like I'm the best boy ever. Is my sweet boy ready for daddy to put his thumb in? Arf, I want to say more but I just can't make the words come out. So I nod and look at daddy as he starts to pull his hand back ever so slightly before he adds his thumb to my hole. I can't help but start to sob as daddy stretches my ass that much more to take his thumb. Oh, that's my good boy, you took daddy's whole hand. I am so proud of you for being my good boy and taking something so big in your tight little hole. The stretch is amazing, but it's so intense my mind is not really tracking all that well. I want to move so I can see daddy's hand disappearing in my ass, but when I move, his hand pulls on ring of muscle in my ass and I can't help but moan. Not even I can tell if it's a good moan or a bad moan, but like always daddy is there taking care of me and starts to twist his hand and push it in a little deeper as he grabs my cock with his other hand and starts to jack me off. I'm so wrung out I don't even try to keep myself from coming as daddy jacks my cock. I'm not tracking well, I'm pretty sure I can still feel his hand both in my ass and on cock as I hear daddy moan and feel his cum shoot all over my legs as he orgasms. I love you, Jamie, daddy says, kissing me as his fucks my ass with his fist hitting my prostate with every thrust as I whimper and moan as I come for the second time. I love you too, daddy. The end.